Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Michigan Business Network Studios, China Channel, of course. I'm Chris Holman, and this is the illustrious mayor of Lansing, very important man, and has done wonderful things for this city. And, of course, Xing Tong, you know, he will be taking over the interview after we start this. Mayor, thanks for coming down to the studio.
My pleasure. Great to see you.
Well, listen, let's do a little thing. Let's do, by way of introduction, let's talk to people about yourself and how you got to where you are.
Oh, do we have to? It wasn't easy. It was a long road, but my aunt started in politics. I was surrounded by, you know, loud Italian people growing up. You know, immigrants. My grandfather came here from Italy. My dad came here from Italy. And they were in the grocery business, like a lot of Italians were. So, but they were also started getting involved in politics. And my grandfather was a big supporter of G. Menin Williams, who was governor at the time. They were always backing one cause or another in addition to doing the business. We all got involved in the family business of grocery, and, you know, the customer is always right. The customer is always right. Very important principle that works in politics as well as in business. So we had that business orientation, and it was what attracted me from the earliest time. I wasn't bad at the grocery business either, but I gravitated toward politics and was student body president in high school and college. I was a student leader, and I took those opportunities. And then right away started running for office. So I ran for county commissioner. That was my first office. I served at the county level for 8 years. While I worked for a legislator, I came to Lansing. My wife and I met my wife in college, and we settled in Lansing. And, of course, it's the state capital, so there was work, regular work. Even when I might lose elections, I was able to work in Lansing. And I never really dreamed I would be mayor of Lansing. I was a legislator, mm-hmm. and I dreamed of going to Congress, maybe. And then, as it happened, we had a great mayor in Mayor Hollister, and that really made me first think about maybe being mayor. I'd never thought about mayor as a position that I was interested in, but Hollister went from legislator to mayor, and he made that transition, and I saw the difference he made in our city, that having a strong leader, what that did for the city. And that's when I really, and then there was a change. He left, and I saw the city sort of going in the wrong direction. And I really decided I would step up and try to be mayor. I lost my first election. So if folks have ever had that experience of going for something and losing, that's okay. That happens. That's part of life, right? You got to just keep at it. So I learned a lot in that race. And then the second time I ran, I won. And I've been mayor this is my 12th year. It's been a phenomenal run. It's afforded me the opportunity to make many new friends around the state, around the country, and even around the world. So it's been a phenomenal, phenomenal learning experience, one that I think will not stop even after I'm no longer mayor.
And by the way, very well known in Washington, D.C., went there and got the bailout for the automotive industry, et cetera. Your tenacity has caused you, on behalf of the city, to get a lot of great things done here, and on behalf of all of us here, we thank you for your work, your yeoman's task. So, Jing?
Hi, Mayor. It's really an honor for me to meet you in this occasion. And please may me to introduce myself first. And this is Xing Tong from People at Work. We are the WeChat platform and the partner of the Michigan Business Network in China. We actually want to get a bridge between U.S. and China, bring more American Chinese students to each country to communicate and study. So that's the background we have. And so the first question that I have for you is actually very simple. Have you been to China before?
Yes, I was at China once. My wife and I were able to go. It was a whirlwind tour. We got a lot done in what seems like a short time. I think, what was it, a week or 8 days, Chris?
It was 8 days, if I'm not mistaken.
It just went by so quickly. But we were very impressed, of course, number one, with the people. We were welcomed. The hospitality was amazing. Even if there were language barriers, we felt the warmth and the love that cannot be made up. You know, either that's there or it's not. And so really, just from regular folks on the street to people that we met in a business setting, everybody was very warm and hospitable. The countryside was beautiful. We had the opportunity to go to the Great Wall to see a few lovely cities, and talk a little bit of business while we were there as well. But it was really just the tip of the iceberg. I felt like it was just, you know, a very nice beginning, a very auspicious beginning, but just the beginning. I really enjoyed all of it. I enjoyed the dialogue, like I say, with regular folks, but also with some of the powers that be, some of the leaders that we had a chance to talk to. I enjoyed talking a little bit of politics. I enjoyed talking about business, talking about the future of our countries together, the United States and China, about the possibilities for prosperity for both sides. You know, we're always looking for a win-win. I learned that in politics and in business. You look for the win-win so that both sides benefit. And I think we have a lot to gain if we can get Chinese people and American working together, and ultimately our countries moving in the same direction, working together.
So also, just for the record, the mayor was in Beijing, Shanghai, Xiamen, and Jinan.
Wow, that's really a lot of cities you've been there. So another question for me is, actually, you said you've been talking to a lot of people, and does that including some of the Chinese students over there?
Yeah, thank you for asking. We had the opportunity to talk to some youngsters and listen to them as well. They had prepared some statements, and we got a chance to sort of listen in on some of what they were working on. And my wife is an educator in Lansing, so she's used to working with youngsters, and we were just both so impressed with their skills, with their, of course, their attitude, their posture, their warmth, but their English language skills were amazing, but their intelligence too. The what they talked about, the questions that they asked. You know, it has been said we should judge a person not on what they say, but the questions that they ask. They were very insightful, these youngsters, and I was really inspired that young people, that the Chinese young people, were thinking about such issues with of gravity, of consequence, serious issues that they were grappling with, and then, you know, the intelligence in their fields as well. So we talked to folks that youngsters that wanted to be, you know, doctors, that wanted to be in mathematics, that wanted to do any variety from a variety of backgrounds, and who aspired to a variety of different careers. Very, very impressive.
Well, Governor, this is really high comments, and I need to say thank you for that.
Absolutely.
And of course, I have another question for you, is that you didn't mention your experience before, and that's really inspiring. But can I ask more questions about your educational Sure. background and the experience you have, and how does this educational stuff to make your transforming or your career like journeys?
Well, you know, I don't come from a family of a long line of college educated people. My dad came here from Italy after World War II, and his education stopped after the eighth grade. My mother didn't have education beyond high school. So I consider myself very fortunate to be able to go on to college. And I just went to a four-year liberal arts school, Adrian College, where I met my bride. So that was my most important achievement. So I give Adrian College a lot of credit. The institution where I got my degree, it's not Harvard. It's not considered one of the greatest schools in the country. To me, it is. But it allowed me to grow as a person, not just to grow academically, that's very important, but it allowed me to mature, to be away from home for 4 years. You know, I took some of those classes I will never use. I took fencing, I remember. Fencing. And I don't fence anymore. It was all part of my growth. It was all part of my education, whether it was speech class or fencing. I was able to, that's what a liberal arts education, you know, it's stretching the mind, the body, in ways that you're just not going to get at home, you know. there are challenges that you undertake that certainly I understand there are people that need to be home, help the family in a variety of ways. And I did that. We had challenges like any family, but I stuck it out at school and I got that degree. It wasn't easy for me. It wasn't easy just to finish my degree, to get my bachelor's degree. But it was very important in my constitution, in my character, to get that. It wasn't so much important what it was in, but it was important to finish. And that college helped build who I am, and the relationships that I built, the opportunities that I had. I got to work at the radio station. I got to work at the newspaper. There was a college newspaper. I got to work at the TV station. There was a little TV station. And in a small school, you're able to do a lot of different things. At Michigan State, you're able to do a lot of different. There's so many opportunities, so many different clubs and organizations. So I think as important as the classroom instruction is and can be, it's also the instruction and the relationships that you build outside the classroom that is part of your growth, part of your education. And if you build those bridges, I still remember some of the international students that we had at Adrian, and some of the late nights that we spent, because they would often be on a different calendar and they would be, I would smell interesting things cooking late at night and I would end up in their rooms. And I formed friendships that will last a lifetime. So it's a tremendous, tremendous opportunity that I encourage folks, if they can. We love our families, and our families, of course, are key to us, but there's a lot of growth that takes place sometimes to move away for a while and in an academic setting that is key to your growth, to your future.
Oh, thanks, Governor. So I may ask for your advice for those like Chinese students who are like, for incoming Chinese students, of course, like when they are pursuing their like academic journey, especially in the college and university, what would you suggest, like how they picking up all these universities and the colleges?
Well, again, I obviously we'd love to have them in Lansing. I mean, sure. And I encourage them, and I think we'll stack up against any community anywhere. So I hope folks will take a good look at Lansing. I'm proud of where we are. What we've accomplished, you know, who we are as a people, the welcoming city that we are. So I hope they'll take a good look at Lansing. But even if they don't pick Lansing, I hope that they'll look carefully and if they can, you know, take that opportunity. And I would say, you know, I wanted to go. My dream was to go to University of Michigan. I just had this picture in my head of, and I visited the school. I used the library, I used the facilities, and I had a vivid picture of University of Michigan. As a high school student, I was on the debate team, and we would go and use, and so I dreamed of, you know, oh boy, to go to U of M. Well, I didn't make it to U of M. My grades, I was not going to make it to U of M. There was just no way. So I went to Adrian, which was not rated as high, but I had a phenomenal experience at Adrian. And my message to those students in China is you can have a phenomenal experience. There is a great experience waiting for you. If it's at Harvard, wonderful. Fantastic. If you make it, you have my strong personal congratulations. My kids didn't make it to Harvard. One applied to a couple Ivy League, and she made it into a couple Ivy League, but she ended up in Michigan. It's really not as important. I know so many people feel that it's vital that they get into this university or that university. From my perspective, it's important that you go, that you get in, that you go to college. You know, get your foot in the door, get started. It's less important to me, my experience, it's less important where or what you study even. You'll find that a lot of people that are successful in business, I think it's something like 60% are working in a field different from what their degree is in.
Yeah.
Again, if your degree, if you know what you want, you know, I'm all for pursuing your dream. If you know you want that doctor, you want to be a medical doctor, or you want to be a lawyer, and you know where you want to go, great, go for it. I always say, you know, the old adage is shoot for the moon and you'll at least land among the stars. You know, I wanted to be president of the United States. I got to be mayor. Okay, I didn't quite make it to be president, but I made it to be mayor, sure, to run a city. So aim high. That's great. But don't get down if you end up at Michigan State or Lansing Community College. These are great institutions. The school I went to is a great institution. A lot of people never heard of it. Well, they don't know the value of it. I know, and my wife, and many other people. And the school has grown since we were there, by the way. The school today, Adrian College, is more respected than it was when I went. Maybe I'm even part of that. So you have an opportunity to build your future. You have an opportunity to create something. No matter where you go, you are going to bring your special talents, and you're going to develop your special talents. So my message is, my message is, do not get bogged down. Don't worry yourself. You know, shoot for the moon. That's great. Go for your dreams. But don't be down if you have to settle for your second, third, fourth choice. It'll be the best choice. That could end up being the best choice. We don't know. None of us have a crystal ball. We don't know what's in store for us in the future. It's what you make of it. If you go to an Adrian College, you go to a Lansing, it's what you put into it. And you can come out great. You will be changed. You will not be the same person. And you can have a wonderful winning experience and a bright future in a place like Lansing, Michigan.
Mayor, you spoke to this a little bit because you mentioned LCC, Lansing Community College. So a lot of times they can't get in the colleges that they wanted to, and especially for exchange students coming from foreign countries. Talk a little bit about the value of going to an LCC, not only to be able to get in, but to pick up on language skills and to have 2 years to get your degree, your first 2 years out of the way, and then transfer where you want.
Well, you hit the nail right on the head. You know, I can't say enough good about LCC, about Lansing Community College. The growth just in the last 20 years of Lansing Community College in every way, its reputation, its academic programs, the physicality of the campus, it's a different college than what it was 20 or even 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And they were turning out good graduates then. I mean, not to say LCC has been the little engine that could, chugging along for decades.
Yeah.
What Phil Gannon started there and a group of other people is amazing. But in the last 10 or 20 years, it's completely reinvented itself again. So LCC is a great place. There is phenomenal learning taking place there. And by the way, people are saving a ton of money because they're going into LCC, getting a lot of the requirements out of the way, getting comfortable with college, you know, making the mistakes that we all make as youngsters at that level, and then moving on to a U of M, to a Michigan State from LCC. And really, from LCC, you can go anywhere.
Yeah.
This is not some low-credentialed institution. It never was, but some community colleges have that reputation. Lansing Community College is among the best. It is among the best, and it will take you where you need to go. They have a great president who is very serious academician, who has just elevated that campus in every regard. And it is one of, I call LCC one of our windows on the world. It is truly an international campus. And again, a welcoming place with the ethic that we want. We've been blessed. You know, when I became mayor, this community, between Lansing Community College and Michigan State, these were our windows on the world. These were really helped to make us a cosmopolitan community. Otherwise, Lansing would probably have just been a sleepy GM town, capital city, more of a sleepy one-horse town without those two places. But when you add Michigan State and Lansing Community College, and right away, successive presidents of LCC have reached out, not just across the state line, but globally, mm-hmm, to build partnerships and unique partnerships around the globe. So students don't have to worry. This is not some small patrician thing. You will be welcomed. You will feel at home, and you will add to the sort of international potpourri that we celebrate every day in Lansing.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so Mayor, you're talking about all these great change opportunities for all these universities and colleges. So the one question that I want to ask for the Chinese students is that how, like, when they are applying for these kind of universities, what admissions will value them most when they are, like, thinking and sorting all these candidates from the China?
How will they be treated? Is the question, how will they be treated by admissions?
What kind of characteristics that value most from the admissions?
What are the assets they bring? I mean, when they look for admission, many times it's not just the academic piece. You alluded to it, experience, internships,
etc. Yeah, it's a funny thing, and I hope folks might have to look this up, but they've done studies on this, and I think that we're well aware of this in Lansing, that what determines one's success in college is, it's a four-letter word called grit.
Grit.
G-R-I-T. And grit is something that's hard to measure, but it's sort of like your guts, what we say, guts. Boy, that person's got a lot of guts. Mm-hmm. It's your stick-to-itiveness. Stick-to-itiveness, your determination. It's not your GPA, your grade point average in high school. They've studied that. It's not how many jobs you've held. It's not how much money you have. It's your level of grit, your level of determination, your level of rolling up your sleeves and just focus and sticking with it. No matter if you hit obstacle or not, that you stay focused and you stay on the job and you stay committed. That's the number one determination. And I believe that that's true in life. So I'm not surprised that that's the number one thing in getting a degree. That's what they want to measure. You know, do you flit from job to job? You know, is your work record, or can you show that you've accomplished something in whatever field? You know, are you a committed person? Are you a serious person? Do you take your obligations seriously? If you say you're going to do something, do you do it? These are the kinds of things that you're going to be measured on. And as I say, sort of grit, your seriousness of purpose, your commitment, your belief in yourself, and your belief in your goals, your commitment to your goals. It's funny, I remember... I put in my college application. I was foolish enough to put that I wanted to be president of the United States. They almost never threw that in my face, but at some point I did get that back. And it might have been they had me back to do the commencement speech a few years ago at Adrian. And they trotted that out and asked if it was okay, if they could use it in the introduction. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I say hold fast to your dreams. Hold fast to your dreams. Don't be embarrassed if you want to be this or want to be that, because you got to dream big, and you know, you'll get somewhere there. But without those dreams, without that gusto, that gumption, that ambition, then for sure you're not going to get there. So you got to have the belief, you got to have the plan, and if Lansing Community College, if Lansing can be part of that plan, if it was meant to be, you know, we'd love to have you here.
Thanks, Mayor. It's my first time to hear the word grit, and it's really impressive. And also, I think you mentioned about like how you get the grit, actually. I think it's more from the, you know, the working experience or the environment that you are like doing your, maybe start your own business or something like that. So can you give us more detailed emphasizing about the working experience, which is, you know, get important in your pursuing your academic degree, or even after, when you're pursuing your career journey afterwards?
I think this is an important across the board, both for academic success and employment, career success. Folks are going to look at, do you have that stick-to-itiveness? You know, what have you achieved? What have you accomplished? Because it's transferable. Okay, the ethic, the work ethic that it takes to plow a field, you know, to grow, to finish a product, to take a product from beginning to finish, It's that work ethic and that commitment. Those skills are transferable, and those will serve you in school. They will serve you in academic, and they will serve you in the career. I look at this when I'm hiring somebody. You know, if they've been, I'm not that impressed. Okay, they've been here, they've been there. What did you accomplish there? And frankly, even if somebody's got a bunch of degrees, you know, you have some folks that are professional students and never got done being a student, and they're a student for 10 years or more, and then they want to get a job. I like to see accomplishment along the way. I like to see internship, you know, that I took on this job, whether for pay or not. I went and did this task. I went and did this. I got this done from a career standpoint. I went and got this career experience. For whether, and again, if it was six months or a year, but I took on this project, and I took this project from A to Z. I took it from start to finish. An employer wants to hire somebody that knows how to finish, do a project. I don't want to hire somebody and have to call them every day and say, how are you doing? How are you doing? Every hour and check on them. I want somebody that's going to be able to go out and do what needs to be done. And academically, you want somebody that's going to be committed. We don't want somebody that's going to come and start and quit. That doesn't help you, and it doesn't help us. That doesn't help our numbers. We want to show, and students should want to go to an institution that wants success. We want success for you for two reasons, at least. One is you're our charge. You know, you are what we do. We believe in taking young minds and developing them. So you are our mission, and we're going to be judged by that, okay? But part of what is an institution, we're going to be judged by how many people start and how many people finish. And if they just quit, if they spend some money and leave without a degree, that hurts our reputation. That doesn't help us. So we want you to succeed for you and for us. And so students should know that you know, we're going to be pushing them to be successful. So the admission process, we're not trying to push people out. We're not trying to weed people out. But we want to make sure for their sake and our sake that they're serious about it. It's not that, oh, well, you've had this challenge in the past. You know, you didn't do this, you didn't do that. We're not trying to make anybody feel bad. The question is, are you prepared now to give this 100%? Are you going to come in here? Are you going to be a serious student? That's what we want to know. That's what we're trying to weed out. Are you ready to work hard now? It's okay. It's okay. We know that we're human beings. Not everything happened perfectly in my life. Not everything happened perfectly according to plan in their life. They shouldn't let that stop them. We're not saying come in here and have everything perfect. Not at all. And don't cover up your mistakes. That's the other thing. Don't cover up your mistakes. If you had a big challenge, you know, maybe you lost a family member. Maybe I had a brother who had mental illness. And I had to help my family, and that cost me some grades. You know, if you had a challenge, just be honest about it. Don't think you got to cover it up. We've all had that. We all have families. Our families aren't perfect. We're not perfect. I don't want students to self-select themselves out and say, oh, well, I just can't because I can't talk about this. It's embarrassing. If you can bring yourself, the issue is we want to go forward with you. We want to go forward. So if there's something in your past that, you know, is you feel is holding you back, you know, I'd encourage them to be upfront with the admissions folks about that. You know, I couldn't do 100% because I was my family. I had to work full time or whatever else. Now I'm ready to do 100%. And we will work with you and help you get to where you want to go in the future. Your past does not determine your future. Your past is your past. And now the question is, what do you want for your future?
That is a fabulous note to end on. Mayor Virg Bernero, thanks so much for all you do, but for coming down here.
My pleasure.
Sharing this with our potential. Sharing, wonderful job. Thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. Appreciate it.
You're observing this on the Michigan Business Beat on the China Channel. I'm Chris Holman. Thanks for being with us.